Hi, welcome to Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your host, Robert Green, and my guest today is Kathy Sullivan. Hi, Kathy.
Hi, Robert.
Kathy is a program manager on the Visual Studio IDE team, and she's here to show us some of the new goodness coming in Visual Studio 2013.
Exactly.
A preview of which is available for your downloading pleasure. Hopefully you already knew that.
Yeah.
So, new things in the IDE.
Oh, yeah.
Why? What was wrong with the old one?
Oh,
perfect, wasn't it?
It was, actually, but we've just made it a lot better. Let me show you a few things that you're really going to like, I think. So, the first thing I want to talk to you about is how now we can sign into the IDE. And you might wonder, well, why would I want to sign into the IDE, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, so the first thing you're going to get when you sign into the IDE is you're going to get your settings synchronized with your environment, right? So first time you install the preview, right, you're going to go and you're going to customize the IDE, right? Maybe you have a favorite theme. Maybe you're one of the people that like line numbers on, like I am.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there's a couple text editor settings that you prefer. And usually you probably manage this with importing and exporting your settings. But today, once
Or you just try to remember the handful of things that you like.
Exactly.
And then after you repave your third machine for the fourth time that year,
yes.
You say to yourself, why do I have to re-enter this stuff over and over and over again?
Exactly. So now you only have to customize your machine once.
Excellent.
And we'll do the rest for you. So let me show you how this works. So in the upper right-hand corner, we now have a little sign-in area. So let's go and we'll sign in. And I'm going to use actually
You're
my
also
own.
Also prompted to do that after installing the very first time you run Visual Studio.
Exactly. So I've actually set up Visual Studio and I said, don't sign me in now. And you can say sign in now or sign in later. And
mm-hmm.
you always have the chance to go back and sign in once you've launched the IDE. So let's go and use my own live IDE. And after I'm logged in, you're going to see some really neat changes take effect here.
Like your name and your picture.
Exactly, yep. And so you'll notice that, actually, it didn't change my, it should have switched to the light theme, but.
But it did change the scroll bar.
It did, yes.
Okay.
So I'm using the enhanced scroll bar over here, which
mm-hmm.
I'll show you in a second. And you'll also see that I have line numbers on, which are not on by default normally.
Right.
And it should have switched my theme, but I was playing around with it a little earlier, so that's why it didn't switch my theme. But now you can see in the upper right-hand corner that the IDE knows who I am. It has my name, it has my photo, as you said, and I can click on the badge and I can see some things about what accounts I'm using, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm logged in, I'm using my visualstudio.com account, and I've got my team project set up here where I keep all my demo projects. And if I head down to account settings, I can see some things about the version I'm running here.
Okay.
And then if you're looking for the place to sign out of the ID, that's where you're going to find that location.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what kinds of things get transferred over or roamed?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And like I always use to find many things in the ID, quick launch. Just control Q.
My favorite feature.
Exactly.
From Visual Studio 2012. I said it then, I'll still say it.
Exactly. So I can start typing and I don't need to type the whole word like Dimitri mentioned
mm-hmm.
a couple times ago. And I get the first option, which is synchronize settings. And now I can also see that I can disable roaming. It's enabled by default.
Mm-hmm.
But I can also pick and choose the things that I want to roam. Like I said, themes, fonts and colors, changes that you make. Maybe you set up some environment aliases in your IDE. Maybe you have favorite keyboard shortcuts that you've bound to
mm-hmm.
different ones. And those are always tough ones to remember. Apparently need a restart here.
Fonts?
Yes. And anything that you make text editor customizations.
Okay.
As well, we'll go and roam
so
those.
So, are there benefits to signing in if you disable syncing?
There are, in that we'll still know about the product that you've registered. So,
okay.
By signing in, you're essentially registering Visual Studio. So, you'll still get all that goodness, and that you can now register right inside the product and take care of all that there,
okay.
Whether you choose to roam your settings or not.
Okay.
So while we're in this dialogue,
mm-hmm.
I want to show you one thing that you've probably heard about, but we see it in action here, and that we now have a search box in the upper right-hand corner.
I did not know that.
Okay,
one.
Well, you
cool.
didn't. So yeah, so we've added search to tools options.
Ooh.
So what's help me think of one of those pages that has a lot of controls.
Pinned.
And,
Pinning. I always want pinned. document windows to show up on a
tabs
to show up on a different line.
Yep. So here we tabs and windows here. Yep.
Does that roam, by the way? So pin tabs in a separate row.
This one does not actually roam. Yes, but so
put that
it's
on
the
my list of things I'd like to
exactly.
See.
It's the startup category. Mm-hmm. It's the text editor category.
Okay.
And then the appearance, which are fonts and colors, and then the theme settings in here. But if we go look at something like the fonts and colors page, and while the layout here hasn't changed, the dialogue itself has now become resizable, right? So, you know, you're traditionally you'd get like, you know, 10 results, but now you have a lot more scrolling area to find that item you're looking for. And as you know, this has been one of those features everyone's asked for a really long time.
Yep.
And we're happy that we were able to bring this into here. Yeah. So the next thing I want to show you, again, in the upper right-hand corner, next to the smiley face, I'll show you in a minute, but we now have a flag up here, and it's got a 3 next to it. And this is what we're calling our new notification center. So if I hover over the flag, it tells me what's in this hub that I'll show you in a second. Mm-hmm. And then it'll open the hub as soon as I click on the flag. So I've got some new stuff in here, right?
Updates.
Exactly. Traditionally, we'd have, or in 2012, we had that balloon that popped up.
Don't you love that traditionally?
Yeah, I know, sorry.
It's a typical thing.
I know.
Microsoft, for you, current version is the next version.
That's right.
The version that the customers think is current is the past version to you.
Exactly.
And the version they think of as the past version is ancient history to us.
It's a,
The next version for us is the one that comes after 2013, but that's science fiction to the customers.
Exactly.
It's that
it's
disconnect.
It's always something different, right? Yeah.
It's always humorous.
So the balloon that popped up, it was very vague. It said you had some updates.
Yes.
It didn't really tell you what you had to update or really anything about it, right? Is it
and
important?
It disappeared after a few seconds.
Right. So if you stepped away from your desk to go get coffee or go get lunch and you came back, you missed it.
For too long. To not be annoying, but too short if you actually wanted to do something.
Exactly.
With it.
And if you X'd it out, the next time you launch Visual Studio, it comes back
That's
up.
That's right.
Right. So it it was actually effective in getting developers to want to install and adopt our updates, but it didn't really give them insight into what was going on.
No, and it also you would have a lot of updates to like NuGet packages you know, SQLite. I get that one all the time. I may be in a project where I'm not using SQLite.
Right.
I don't necessarily need to update SQLite now. But I click on the balloon to see what needs to be updated. And while I'm in there, I might as well update.
Everything.
Then I have to restart. And then, you know, that breaks my flow. So
exactly
the ability
right.
to know that there are that there might be updates and then go to it whenever I want.
Pick and choose, right?
Better.
So think of it like a to-do list, right?
Yes.
And now that it's not being intrusive, right? So I can easily glance up and see what's in that flag to decide if I want to go look in there or not. So
when you hover, you hover over it and
So the flag will tell you what's in there. I have nothing new, so I know that I've already seen everything.
So you can do a peek. And then decide if it's something you need right now. If it's not, you continue on and go back to it.
Exactly.
Play.
And
that's
if I just click in the editor, it just disappears. It doesn't block anything that I care about or that I'm working on. So you'll now see all of your things like product updates and extension updates. Maybe you have some samples installed. Mm-hmm. Any updates that get pushed out through the gallery will come in the notification hub.
Right.
Also things like we've streamlined our first launch experience. And we used to be able to opt into or download offline help there. But we've moved that out to kind of simplify those steps and kind of get you right into the IDE. So now stuff like that you'll find in the hub, places where we're trying to bring informational things that are relevant to you and that you actually care about. We're trying to bring them into one place so you can come and see, hey, what is it that is going on with my IDE? What do I need to take care of?
Yep.
If your trial is expiring, for example, you'll see a message like that. For the most part, these are informational. They're strictly optional. But something like your trial expiring, you might want to go and take care of that before you're not able to use it anymore.
Does your Windows 8 developer license expiring show up in there?
It doesn't, but that's definitely
something. That's another one.
Exactly. That would be good for future iterations.
Okay.
So if I want to go and install something, I simply click on the title, and I get brought right to that location. Yeah,
which, and you can just continue to go to this dialog and go to updates.
Right. And the hub is just really a place to surface these things. It isn't the sole place that contains these.
Is the balloon gone?
The balloon is gone. All right. No more in 2013.
Okay.
So if I were to say, I don't actually want this SDK, I can go and dismiss it. But if I go back into the extensions and updates manager, it'll still be there.
Okay.
I'm just dismissing the reminder, essentially.
Very good.
Yeah. And then if I want to clean them all up, I can dismiss all of them. Mm-hmm. And then you'll see that my flag is empty. Hence, the hub is also empty. Okay. So I can use the flag to kind of sense what's in there and if I want to go and take a look at it as well.
Cool.
Yeah. And so, like I said, we streamlined the first launch experience. So now when you launch Visual Studio, you'll get the ability to sign in. And if you choose not to sign in, that's when you can pick a theme as well. So we now have the blue theme we've integrated into the product. So we introduced it in Update 2, I think. And also in the Matt Johnson's color theme editor, we had a version of the blue theme. But now it's built right in to the IDE. And so I've got three themes to choose. Mm-hmm. So now when I start up the IDE, I get the option to pick one of these themes. And so I kind of have a better chance of landing in the theme that I'm most comfortable with and that mm-hmm. I'm going to enjoy writing code in, as opposed to sort of just whatever default theme is picked for me. That's the one I end up in. In most cases, I don't know. Our developers didn't really know there were other themes. So we wanted to increase that awareness, so we brought that into the first launch experience. Yeah, I'm going to actually just switch over to the light theme real quick and show you some of the minor but really useful updates we've made to the overall look and feel of the IDE. So one of them that is actually one of my favorites, if I zoom into the lower right-hand corner, you'll notice that we now have a lot more definition mm-hmm. around these windows, so I can find out where something ends and something begins. And if you wanted to go in, let's say, make the Solution Explorer window bigger, in Visual Studio 2012, it was really hard to find that point where the cursor changed from my arrow to the two arrows. So we added a lot more definition around places in the IDE where you need that separation. You'll also notice that there's a splash of color across the IDE. And the Solution Explorer is one of those great places to see that, examples of it, like the folder icon, mm-hmm. where you can use it as a beacon to find your way around the IDE, whether it's in Solution Explorer or in the toolbar, and then some other little things. We've increased the contrast, and so you can tell now what is selected. I think before it was a gray color, so it really blended in.
The colors
in a bad way.
The colors actually help.
Yeah,
I was a couple days ago bouncing back and forth between 2012 and 2013, and I mean, I'd seen the colors before, and I thought, that's nice.
Yep.
But I didn't think that I would ever really care. But the other day, I was bouncing back from 2012 to 2013, and when I was in 2013, it's colorful, it's bright, it's happy.
It is,
and
yes.
It actually made a difference. I was surprised.
Yeah, I was
surprised that it made a difference to me, because, I'm usually just heads down on the code.
Exactly, yeah. I think a lot of folks are going to find that it's going to feel a lot better and just feel more natural, as opposed to always missing something.
And it really helps if you are bouncing back and forth between 2012 and 2013. You've got the same project open in both.
Exactly.
Because in this instance, I had a Windows 8 project open in 2012 and the 8.1 version open in 2013, and it's essentially the same project.
Sure.
And with the exact same names, of course.
Yep.
And now I can easily tell which one I'm in. So if for no other reason than that, it's a great feature.
Yeah, that's really great to hear. Also, if you're working exclusively in 2013 and you have multiple instances open, which a lot of folks do, mm-hmm. We now have made some changes to the way we display the title of them. So before, they looked identical, so you didn't know which one you had your focus in. So now the logo's purple, and it has a little bit of a darker text, and the inactive one is just a little grayed out. Just some minor things to help you use the IDE better. And then one other thing I want to call out, I can't show you here, but it's really important that everyone knows that we really invested heavily in high DPI for these new dense screens, mm-hmm. these high dense screens that are coming out. I mean, you're seeing them in all these conferences, are releasing more devices, and across every team in Visual Studio, we had this concentrated effort to make sure that Visual Studio looks beautiful on these screens. And we knew it had been a problem for a while. And we had a lot of scaling problems. Mm-hmm. We had buttons that were clipped, text you couldn't read, just to name a few. And so I think we fixed over 200 bugs in 2013 to make sure that when you're running on high dense screens that you see something that's usable and that cool. just looks really good. So we obviously can't see it here today, but right. yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
That helps people who are using Visual Studio on their tablet-like devices.
Exactly. Yes.
Yep. Cool.
So it's going to look really crisp. And it's pretty exciting.
Excellent.
Yeah, yeah. So the next thing we should jump into is some of the editor improvements that we've made, right? So for writing code and navigating code and finding your way around your code. So we actually pulled a bunch of the top features from the productivity power tools. And you know, we like to do that every release. We like to take those top features and pull them in and make them first class citizens in the IDE. So a couple of them we've taken over is auto brace completion, mm-hmm. The enhanced scroll bar, and then we've also made some other improvements to our Navigate 2 experience, and then I'll show you this new Peak experience that we have that you've already seen too, but it's so cool that you have to see it again, right? So in the auto brace completion, so if I start, let's go and create a new method here. And when I add my first curly brace, you'll see the second curly brace is automatically completed mm-hmm. for me. And this is going to help me write code a lot faster and write my code a lot cleaner.
Right.
It also works in C++. So if I jump over to a C++ file and I have my quotes, I get the quote completion there as well in C++. Along with this, I also get some really, I also get some automatic code formatting as well. So if I do like a 1+1 and then I add that semicolon, you'll notice we're going to add that white space in for you. Again, it's going to help you write your code a lot faster and keep it a lot cleaner as you're going. And you can also customize. So I just typed in the beginning of code formatting. And so you can actually come in here. Okay. Yeah, and you can, these groups right here, for indentation, new lines, spacing, and wrapping, they've now added some customizations around those. So if you're not happy with the defaults or you want to make some changes, you can go and make those changes as well, specifically for C++.
Cool.
And then another neat thing I should show you is the ability to jump between your C++ implementation files and your header files really easily. Before you had to right-click in the editor, and I think it was... we've still left the option there, but now it's more of a toggle as opposed to we just take you there and leave you there.
Okay.
And then you have to find your way back. So I can now toggle between these two. That's not the right one. But now I can toggle between these two, or I can use the shortcut. So I open the header file. I can use Control K and Control O to jump between these really quickly, because a lot of times I'm writing code in both these files and I need to get back and forth between them pretty quickly. So let's head back here. And then actually there was the third productivity power tool feature. It was move line up and down. And holding down the Alt key and up and down, I can now take a single line and move it around, or I can highlight a couple lines. And using the Alt key, I can move a couple lines up and down. So I can do, I can refactor really quickly when I can just grab a couple lines and use my keyboard to kind of move them around and act really fast that way. So moving on, the enhanced scroll bar that I showed you that I like to roam with my settings. I can now right-click on the scroll bar, and I get my scroll bar options right from the scroll bar. I can also use Quick Launch and type in scroll bar, and I can jump right to that page where I can go and make my changes. And I like to show the options window right next to it, because you'll see that I've got a lot of annotations in this scroll bar. I have my changes, which are that yellow, the yellow mark there. The blue line across is my where my cursor is. The red annotation is an error in my code. And then I've got some breakpoints down below. And this is super helpful if you're setting those breakpoints and then you've got this really long file and you're like, oh, where was that breakpoint I set, right? So the enhanced scroll bar is going to give you that nice aerial view of your code, and you can sort of just click around in it and we'll jump right to that location.
Yep.
And then you've got two types of scroll bars. You've got the bar mode, which is the traditional Windows scroll bar. And then the map mode, which I'm using, and I'm using the medium size, but you can also pick a couple different sizes based on how much screen real estate you have. And then I also have the preview on as well, which gives me sort of that that zoomed in view of my code as I hover over it. So I can see exactly where, I can make sure I want to go there before I actually click there. The next really great addition to the editor is our new and improved Navigate To experience. So Navigate To is Control Comma is the shortcut. And I have had Shopping Cart underneath my cursor. And instead of popping up a dialogue that was blocking the UI, and if you needed to go back and look at your code, you either had to move the dialogue or hit cancel.
Right.
It's now right in line.
Cool.
So I get all my results similar to the find and replace experience we introduced in 2012. It's now in the upper right-hand corner. It's not blocking my code, and I can use the keyboard to scroll through it. And I also get the goodness of the preview tab as well. So I didn't have Shopping Cart open, but it opened it in the preview tab. And as I go through this list, you'll see, my editor is changing to reflect the item I select.
Nice.
And I'm still using the preview tab, which is pretty great. I get a lot of the familiar stuff from the old Navigate To experience, like the icons help me figure out what it is I'm actually looking at and the type. And then I also get the path for some of those.
And can you right now replace Shopping Cart with Shopping Cart Remove? Can you type in there and do a search?
I can, yes.
And it fills. Yep. Excellent.
So, yeah, isn't that great?
Right. So you were looking for Shopping Cart and you realized you were looking for something entirely different.
Yep.
So it's just totally
interactive. And I can go and change that search.
Cool.
Yeah. And then I can escape out, and you'll see I'm brought right back to the place where I was. So I don't have to find my way back. Oh, where was it that I was trying to navigate? I didn't find what I was looking for, maybe, for example. But now I'm right back to where I was, working, and I can get right back to work.
Excellent.
Yeah. So now I can make some more informed decisions before I go and actually select that result. So, All right. So the next I'm going to jump to this other application I have here, and I really love Peak. I think it's going to change the way people work, and I really think our team is, they've been working really hard on this, and it's really cool to kind of see it all come together, see people get really excited about it. So Peak is, it's essentially a go-to definition, but it's now inline, right? And so go-to definition was F12, but the shortcut for Peak is Alt F12. And but now I get this this sort of inline view. My code is kind of pushed out of the way, right?
Also, just noticed that it also shows you the.
And that's really
bar.
Cool because the Peak window is it's tiny, right? I'm looking at my laptop here, and it's taking up a big chunk of my screen. But I get my enhanced scroll bar to help me find my way around my Peak window as well. I've got line numbers on. I've got full colorization in here. I've got things like where my current focus is as well. We utilize the preview tab as well.
Is that resizable? I just noticed.
It's not resizable right now. Yeah. But that's definitely something that the team's considering.
And it's also read-only.
It is read-only. Yeah. That's another thing that the team's considering for the final release of 2013. Yeah. So from here, I can actually keep drilling in the Peak window. So let me scroll down and find something else I want to go to the definition for. And I can Alt-12 on that. And then if I pick something else, and I Alt-12 on that, you'll now see I have a little breadcrumb here. See those dots?
Yeah.
So I can find my way back within my Peak window and kind of trail back to where I was looking. I can use the mouse to click through these. Or I can actually use the shortcut. So the shortcut is Control-Alt-minus to go back, and then Control-R equals, it shares the same key as the plus sign, to go forward and backward through these. Yeah, so I can use the Peak window without even taking my hand off the keyboard as well. And then to close the Peak window, I just hit escape, and then my code collapses back in.
So one other potential idea is that you figure out some way in the Solution Explorer to show you what project those files are in. It might. I don't know how to do that without having the Solution Explorer be flipping back and forth. But
exactly,
there might be a way to do it, or there might be a button you press to sort of temporarily sync the Solution Explorer so you can see where that
exactly,
file is.
Exactly, yeah. Or maybe it's something where you just, if the project isn't expanded, you just highlight it or something.
Yeah.
You know, just a way.
Something like that.
Yeah, that could be really interesting, yeah. So then the last thing I want to show you that's really, really awesome are these code lenses. If you look right above line 16 here, I actually have two of the lenses. There's a couple other lenses, but since I'm not actually connected to a team project that supports the other lenses, I only get two of them right now. So I get the first one, which is references, and I can also hover over them to get like a peek of the code in the tooltip, and I can use my keyboard to up and down arrow throughout them, and then enter would just take me to that location.
The references are very cool.
Yeah.
To be able to do that in line without necessarily right-clicking and view all references and have another dialog that comes up.
Exactly, yep. Yeah. I get a quick peek at it. You know, think of it like a GPS for your code, right? Mm-hmm. You're as you're driving, you know, actually we were just having a conversation of Italy, right? And, you know, the GPS was super helpful in Italy, right? Told you when your exits were coming, maybe there's restaurants off to the side when you're going over the speed limit, which is very important. Exactly.
And it's also, yeah. it tells you right then and there if you've got a method that's not being used, because it would have zero references.
Exactly,
I discovered that the other day in the same code I was looking at. I looked at this method, it's got zero references,
right.
I'm like, oh, okay, well, delete.
Right, I should do something.
Immediately, yeah.
Exactly, yep. And then escape closes it, and the other lens I have here is my unit test lens. And I get a nice little, well, it's cut off here, but a nice little green arrow that tells me that this unit test actually passed. And I could go and double click on that, and now I open up that unit test page there. Yeah. But then there's also some shortcuts for these, which if I hold down the Alt key, I see that, so I only have the second and the third one enabled here, but Alt 2.
What's the first one?
It's one of the TFS ones, yeah. So TFS is going to really light this up and add about three, I think, or four more.
Because it shows you when code was last checked in, who checked
exactly,
it in, et cetera.
Exactly, yeah. So let's go, so they're under code information indicators, yeah. And you can see that I get other things like who tested it, what are the change sets that are associated with them. And then from there, I can double click on those change sets and open them right up. So this is really great if you're... What happened to this code? You know, who touched it? You know, what was the history of it? So, TFS is really going to make the data that you're going to see in these code lenses a lot richer.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So the last few things I want to talk about, as always, since we're in preview, we want feedback.
Yes.
And we want thoughts, likes, dislikes, loves. We want them all. And so there's a few ways that customers can give us feedback right from within the IDE. And up to next to Quick Launch and the new notifications flag, we have Send a Smile.
Mm-hmm.
And if folks are already using some of the recent releases of Office, it's very similar to that. So right from within the IDE, you can either send us a smile or send us a frown. And this is pretty instantaneous.
So do you have a prediction or a pool as to whether you get more smiles or frowns and what the percentage will be?
I'm sure someone is tracking that somewhere, yes.
You should do that.
Yeah. But this is actually what I really love about Send a Smile is that I can be at my desk throughout the day and I just pull up this feedback site. I can search for either things I'm working on or things I'm really interested in seeing how customers are reacting to. And it's just right there. It's right at my fingertips. So it makes the collection of feedback a lot easier for folks on the team.
Cool.
Yeah, and then the last thing, I'm gonna go up to Tools Options and down to the Extensions and Updates Manager. And I'm gonna search for the feedback tool here. And this is just another way to give us feedback, but the feedback tool is gonna give us a lot more, a lot richer data. So, folks who are using 2012, they probably noticed that we really invested in performance and, you know, moving things onto different threads so that you're not being blocked from doing your work, whether you're loading a solution or building a solution, for example. And how we found those scenarios where customers were sitting and waiting or Visual Studio was hanging is folks who installed this tool and sent us lots of data that we were able to use to analyze and figure out exactly where these problems were and pinpoint these issues. So this tool is going to give us more than just your sentiment, whether you're happy or sad, right. This is going to give us a lot of information that we can really use to improve areas, especially like performance. Mm-hmm. So.
Cool.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there's also the user voice site.
Exactly, yes.
So if you just want to tell the team directly, like yep. this, didn't like that, where's this, mm-hmm. you can use the smile or frown.
Exactly.
If you want to involve the community, get votes behind exactly. your ideas, and user voice is still a great place.
Yep. And connect for bugs.
Yes.
As always.
Of course.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah, it's exciting.
So the productivity power tools, pretty much everything that was in the Pro Power Tools is now in the product, right?
There might be
a couple things that didn't make it
in. Yeah, just the ones I mentioned we brought over.
Okay, this time around. Some of them were in previous, got into to 2012.
2012, exactly, yes. Yep. So this time it was just auto brace completion, the move line up and down, and the enhanced scroll bar.
Okay.
Yep.
So could we expect additional productivity power tools? The great thing about that is it was a way for you to try out ideas without making it an official feature of the product.
Exactly.
Right.
Yep.
If you put an idea into the product and then you change your mind, now you're cutting features, which is not always good to do.
Exactly.
You put it in extension and you try something and it fails miserably, you just say, oh, all right, that failed miserably. Yep. Thanks for helping us determine that was a bad idea.
Yep.
Let's redo it. So would we expect to see those types of things?
I definitely think so, yeah.
Okay.
Like you said, it's one of the best ways for us to get our early ideas and early prototypes that are, in some cases, are pretty polished, mm-hmm. Out in front of our customers, get their feedback, have them tell us what they love, what they wish it would do.
Right.
I think you're going to continue to see it.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, Robert.
All right, if you have Visual Studio 2013, if you've downloaded it and installed it, hopefully you learned a couple new things. Definitely try out the things in here. We think that they'll definitely improve your productivity. If you haven't downloaded it yet, go get it. What are you waiting for? And we'll see you next time on Visual Studio Toolbox.